Yes, Tony, we're in prayer. Father, we thank you for your word, the Logos, Lord, the printed word. And Father, we ask you tonight that your Holy Spirit would be our instructor. Lord, tonight you would give us understanding, Lord, that we're seeking, understanding that we have been lacking, Lord. But Father, our prayer is that your Spirit would speak to our spirit, that you would open our eyes that we might see, Lord, and open our ears that we would hear what the Spirit of the Lord would say to us. Father, speak to us now. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
We are in Trimester 3, Week 5. Trimester 3, Week 5 is establishing priorities by the standard, by God's standard. We go through life setting our priorities as life happens to us. Unfortunately, most people do not know how to establish priorities, so we just kind of go through life and let life happen, and then we just kind of learn to roll with the punches. But you know, in Proverbs, the Lord says, you choose the path you're going to walk, and then I'm going to direct your steps to try to keep you on that path. And, you know, from time to time, as Mark and I were talking earlier, from time to time, what happens is we'll stray off the path, because God has given us free will. He's given us the right, the power, the authority to choose where we're going to go and what we're going to do. But what I believe the Lord does is he says, okay, you've chose this path of righteousness and you've made some good choices here, but that last choice you made wasn't really what I had in mind for you. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of lead you like herding sheep. I'm going to kind of lead you back on that path because you got off just for a little bit, okay? Sometimes I believe he will place a door before us, and because it's an opportunity, and because it's what he wants, it's what he would like to happen for us. But what happens once we get there, because of somebody else's free will, it doesn't happen, okay? So God does it. Now God always has a perfect plan, right? Okay, so what he does is he leads us through that door so we can help somebody over here. Now, God knows ahead of time they're not gonna listen. Okay? But he's gonna send you over there anyway. Go to Ezekiel 12.
Give them an opportunity.
Ezekiel 12. Perfect example. Okay, because he told Ezekiel, he said, I'm going to tell you now, the rebellious house, they're not listening. They're not going to listen to you, but you got to go anyway. You know what? He told Jonah, he said, you know, I want you to go over here to Nineveh. And Jonah said, oh, no, 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 no. No way, God. Pardon me. No way, God, I'm not going over there because those people don't like me. Those people will kill me. So I'm not going over there. Okay? Now, God knew that eventually they would accept the word, right? So God has a plan, and he kind of leads us down this path. And when we kind of stray off of it for a little bit, then he tries to get us back onto it, okay? Most of our lives we live trying to establish our priorities with our intellect and our common sense, okay? See, we go through life trying to figure out where we're supposed to be with our common sense. You know, and like I've told guys in the recovery classes for years, guys, your common sense, your great intelligence, your brilliant mind has got you where you are today. You just got out of prison and you're still stuck on drugs or alcohol. So, and you use common sense to get you here. See, I think God gives us common sense because we need something to guide us when we're not listening to Him. So He gives us common sense. Well, what does that mean? That means that common sense keeps us alive. Hello? Common sense keeps us alive until we learn to listen to Him. See, what we don't realize as Christians is that we should not live our lives being led by common sense. In Romans 8:14, Paul said, "Those who are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God." That's how we learn to get our priorities right. How? By being led by the Spirit of God. Okay? And not being led by our common sense. You can ask, you walk up to any stranger on the street and ask them, give them a scenario and say, what should I do? I need some money. Should I go rob the bank across the street? And they're going to say, well, no, common sense will tell you. You better not rob the bank, you're going to prison. Okay? Whatever is common sense is the answer you're going to get from the world. That's the best they can do. All right, but we as men and women of God have something more, have something better to depend on. And that is being led by the Spirit of God. Okay, so, and that doesn't, let me tell you, that does not always agree with your common sense. Common sense will tell you, if you're looking for a job, for example, common sense will tell you, take the one that pays the most money. The Lord says, take the one that has the right job assignment. And that's the kingdom job assignment, yeah. Not the world's job assignment. Amen? So, we got to understand that the way to get through life is not being led by our common sense. We don't set our priorities by our common sense, but we set our priorities by God's standards. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. And what we're going to do here is we're going to back up to Let's back up to verse 31 for now. Therefore, and this is in red in my Bible, by the way, and I think that means Jesus doing talking. Jesus said, therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all, these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. So he says, we don't have to worry about tomorrow. We don't have to worry about what's going to happen tomorrow. We don't have to worry about what if tomorrow, or supposing tomorrow, because tomorrow is going to take care of itself. Okay, so what we have to do is we have to get our bearings straight. You know, when you go into the woods, you gotta take a compass. And why do we need a compass? We need a compass to be sure we always understand where we are, right? The question is, where am I? And am I really where I think I am? Hello? Now, I don't know about you, but there have been a few times in my life when I, even being in the woods, where I was not where I thought I was. Or I would be on a journey, I'd be on a taking a trip, and it'd be in the middle of the night, I'm driving down the road, and I'm thinking, I know where I am, but then I'd see a landmark, and I'd realize, oh, I'm not where I thought I was. Well, see, that's the way it is in our Christian life, too. Sometimes we realize, I'm not where I thought I was. Maybe it's because I'm confronted with a situation that I wasn't anticipating, and because I did not handle it properly within the spirit, within the right spirit. So that tells me, well, I wasn't as spiritually mature in that area as I thought I was. And God does things or allows things to happen to us to show us where we really are. Sometimes it shows us that we are not where we think we are. Turn with me to now back in Matthew 6. Again, we're going to back up to verse 19. Let's go back. As a matter of fact, let's... Yeah, let's go to verse 19. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Wow. Where your treasure is, your heart will be. You know, sometimes the Lord will show us that our heart is not as pure as we think it is. He'll show us that we have started allowing our priorities to be set by our circumstances, by our situation. And situations are always temporary, right? That means if our situation changes, our priorities will change. Okay? But if our priority is set on the kingdom of God, it will never change. He wants us to see where our priorities are and how we got those priorities set in our life. Is it just me or is it getting a little warm in here?
I think it's just you.
Just me? No? Okay. Can somebody give us a little air? At least cut off the heat, please. Okay, so in Matthew 6, here again, he's talking about setting our heart on the things of the kingdom, that setting our priorities by the kingdom of God. Okay, so if we're focused on the kingdom, when we set our priorities, they will be set on the right path. They'll be set on the kingdom, okay, and not be set on our situation or our circumstances. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew 28, beginning in verse 18. it's time to go.
It's time to go.
That's ironic. You know, for the last 3 days, I've been saying, Lord, you know what? I'm a simple kind of guy. Lord, all I need is a simple answer. Don't give me all this stuff. Just tell me simple. Stay or go.
Hello.
Okay.
Okay. Well, I got your answer.
Did he hear?
I hope so.
Oh,
I heard it. It's okay. We got it on tape.
Matthew 28, verse 18. Alrighty then.
It's going viral.
Really?
And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying,
that was too good.
All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Well, you know, we have to be careful what we ask for sometimes. You know, God is very literal, I believe. You better be sure you have the answer, because it may be what you're not expecting.
Oh, you think it's, you think you have another question?
Counting the cost. Turn with me to Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9, verse 23. Then he said to them all, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and is himself destroyed or lost? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, of him the Son of Man will be ashamed when he comes in his own glory and in his Father's glory and the glory of all the holy angels. So we have to count the cost, and we have to be ready to respond without reservation. That means we can't be a Moses. See, Moses, when God told Moses, he said, I got a job assignment for you, Mo. And Mo said, oh yeah, but.
Have to be Elijah.
Yeah. So he went. Have to be Elijah. So he went. Because every time the word tells us that every time the Lord spoke to Elijah, it says, and so he went. God spoke to Elijah and told him, this is your job assignment, Elijah. And the word says, and so he went. You know, and I've said for years, I want to be a so he went.
Amen.
I really want to be a so he went. So now I become a so he gone. Okay, turn with me to Luke chapter 14. Luke chapter 14. Verse 25.
Wow.
Luke chapter 14, verse 25. Now great multitudes went with him, and he turned and said to them, If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. Now, let me stop right there, because that brings it close to home for me, personally. Because, see, I'm a relationship guy. Wherever I go, I want to build relationships. The problem is that Jesus is saying right here, if you allow these relationships to keep you out of my will. See, we have to be willing to lay down those relationships, or at least move on from them, to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Because we have to realize that God plants us in a field only for a season. You know, when the farm, I grew up on a farm in Louisiana, and as a boy, a young boy, I remember helping my dad plant corn and sweet potatoes and all kinds of vegetables. But you only plant, when you plant seed, you only plant for a season. You don't plant it for the whole year, and you don't plant it for years to come. You plant it for a season. And Jesus used planting seed and soil several times in his speaking to the multitude. So a lesson for us to learn, to carry away from this, is that I cannot allow relationships to come with people to come between the relationship between me and my Lord. That is the ultimate relationship that I have to protect, and I have to be willing to walk away from father, mother, wife, children, brothers, sisters, yes, and even his own life. Even a good friend. And whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you intending to build a tower does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it? Lest after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, This man began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king going to make war against another king does not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks conditions of peace. So likewise, whoever of you does not forsake everything and everyone that he has cannot be my disciple. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. See, I remember putting myself in a situation at one point in my life when I said, Lord, I'll go anywhere in the world. I'll do anything in the world you want me to do. But don't ever ask me to give up this. Within 6 months, I had lost it all. You would think I would have learned my lesson. But I'm still slow to move when the Lord calls I'm still slow to respond when the Holy Spirit speaks. Father, forgive me. Turn to Luke 18. Luke chapter 18, verse 18. Now a certain ruler asked him, Jesus, "Good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" So Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not bear false witness, honor your father and mother." Now let me stop right there and say, at this point, this rich young ruler was a ruler in the local community and was a ruler in the synagogue. He was a spiritual leader. If you do some study, some background study on this, you'll see that he was a leader, a spiritual leader in the community. He had all of salvation that he could possibly have at that point. Jesus had not died yet, so all he could do, the best he could do, would be to try to live by the Ten Commandments. We know that nobody could ever do that, but by God's grace, those in the Old Testament, they were saved anyway when they tried to live by the commandments. And he was one, a spiritual leader in the community, so he had salvation. He wasn't asking for salvation there when he said, "What must I do to have eternal life?" What he was asking, if you do a word study, you see what he was asking was, what do I have to do to have as much God as you have? To have the kind of relationship with God that you have? So, Jesus answered and said, "Well, son," and he named off a few of the Ten Commandments. And the rich young ruler said, "All these things I have kept from my youth." So when Jesus heard these things, he said to him, "You still lack one thing. Sell all that you have and distribute it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven." Now, he didn't say you'll have salvation. Come on. He didn't say you'll be saved, because he already had that.
Amen.
He said what you'll do is build up treasure in heaven, and you will have treasure in heaven, and then come follow me. But when he heard this, he became very sorrowful, for he was very rich. And when Jesus saw that he became very sorrowful, he said, "How hard it is for those who have riches to enter into the kingdom of God." Now, the kingdom of God was not salvation. All right? So you can have salvation and not live in the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? The kingdom of God abides in me, right?
Amen.
So if the kingdom of God abides in me,
there's the Holy Spirit.
Then he's not talking about here about salvation. He's talking about the kingdom of God abiding. And what does the word tell us the kingdom of God is? Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. All right? So righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Now, he didn't have, obviously, he did not have peace. He was a rich man, but did not have peace. Unfortunately, most rich people don't have peace. They live in constant fear that somebody is trying to steal what they have. They're lacking peace. They cannot be dwell in the kingdom of heaven, in the kingdom of God. Okay? And those who heard it said, who then can be saved? But he said, the things which are impossible with men are possible with God. Then Peter said, see, we have left all. See, look at us. Look at us, teacher. We've left everything. Jesus said, just to follow you. And Jesus said, assuredly, I say to you, there is no one who has left house or parents or brothers or wife or children for the sake of the kingdom of God, who shall not receive many times more in this present life, hello, and in the age to come, eternal life. See, reality, if you use common sense, if you allow common sense to set your priorities, common sense will probably tell you, you know what? The cost is too great. Just like with a rich young ruler, I don't want to go there. I'm sorry, Master. I just don't want to go there. I'm not willing to give up everything. How many people have allowed even in marriages, have allowed a relationship with another person to come before their relationship with the Lord? I cannot tell you how many people I've talked to over the years that said, I know he's not saved, but I love him. Wait a minute. What did the Lord say about that? The Lord said, don't be unequally yoked. Bottom line, don't be unequally yoked. But I love him. What did he say? But I'm not willing to give up all that. The cost is too high. I'm not willing to pay that price. My counsel to people, men and women, that have told me that, well, I believe God brought her into my life, or I believe God brought him into my life so I can disciple them. Well, you're deceived.
Come on, brother.
He told you to disciple him. He didn't tell you to marry him.
Amen.
There's a difference. How long will it last? Alrighty then. Luke chapter 6. Boy, Luke's just full of wisdom, isn't he? We're getting a big dose of Luke tonight.
Very smart man.
Luke chapter 6, verse 46. Let's back up. Let's back up to verse 43, just for grins. For a good tree does not bear bad fruit, nor does a bad tree bear good fruit. For every tree is known by its own fruit. For men do not gather figs from thorns, nor do they gather grapes from a bramble bush. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good. And an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart brings forth evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaks. Wow. You wanna face the test? You wanna know where you really are? Not where you wanna. Where you want to believe you are, not where you think you are. You want to know where you really are? Listen to yourself talk. Because what's in your heart's coming out. And if you're always talking about doubt and fear and worry, guess where you are? You're not standing on the rock by faith. Wow. Either we trust God or not, right?
Amen.
Either we trust Him. But God, what if? But I'm not sure that's going to work. But what if? What if that company goes bankrupt? What if I'm over there for 3 months and they do away with my job? What if? What if? What if God's in control?
Amen.
What if God is really in control? But why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things that I say? Whoever comes to me and hears my sayings and does them, I will show you whom he's like. He's like a man building a house who dug deep and laid the foundation on the rock. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently against that house and could not shake it. For it was not, because it was founded on the rock being Jesus. But he who heard and did nothing is like a man who built his house on earth without a foundation, against which the stream beat vehemently, and immediately it fell. And the ruin of that house was great. See, we're talking about building a spiritual house through this whole 9 months. We spent the first trimester setting the foundation, John 8:32. Mark, we need to remember the foundation that we set in the first trimester. We set the foundation, set the house on the rock of Jesus. John 8:32, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. That word know is not knowledge, but it's understanding. We need to understand who Jesus really is. We need to be sure we understand who Jesus is to me and who he is in my life. That is the foundation, understanding. Knowledge will never set you free from anything, only understanding. Trimester 2, we built the walls to the house. Matthew 6:33, we started off tonight's lesson with. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then all these things shall be added unto you. All what things? Everything you need. Everything you need. But we got to trust him. Seek him. Seek his righteousness. Seek the kingdom of God, be led by the Spirit of the Lord, so he can provide these things. And he says, you know what? You've chosen, you're on the right path. You started out on a good foundation. Now we got you going with the perimeters. We're setting the perimeters, building the walls to your house. So stay focused. Stay focused on these perimeters. Don't get outside of these perimeters. As you're walking that path of righteousness, and now we're in trimester 3, we're putting the roof on the house, which is Luke chapter 6, verses 46 through 49, we're just reading. We have to learn to withstand the test. How do we withstand the test? We start off with a good foundation. We set the walls, the perimeters for our life, which it means we're being led by the Spirit of God. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who accordingly to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven forever for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, it need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love, though now you do not see him, yet believing, you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. It will never fade. It will never fade. If I establish my priorities and I'm led by the Spirit of God, it will never fade. My priorities will always be the same. They will remain steady. Unfortunately, we normally decide what we need to do, and then we ask the Lord to get involved with us and bless what we're doing. Too many times we don't even bother to ask Him if it's what He wants us to do. Anytime we step out without seeking His guidance first, we're in disobedience. And as we have discussed before, that takes us out of position to receive anything from God. Did you even ask? Turn with me to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, verse 18. Romans chapter 1, verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, His invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify Him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness and the lust of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use of what is against nature. Likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another. Men with men committing what is shameful and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error which was due. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents. Whoa. That hits home, huh? Look at our society today. Undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only to do the same, but also approve of those who practice them. Whoa. So the next time somebody asks you, well, how can God, if he's so loving, how can he send people to hell that do these things? Refer them to Romans chapter 1. Tell them to read the whole chapter.
Amen.
And they'll see, hopefully, that God didn't do it. They condemned themselves by their choices because they chose their priorities. They established their priorities by common sense. What other people like, what other people want, what other people expect, instead of using God's standards for setting our priorities. Turn with me to Proverbs chapter 14. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12. There is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. That kind of sums it all up. The end of what seems right, the end of our common sense, is death. Maybe we should have asked what God thought, huh? So what's the value? What is the value of being led by the Spirit of God? What good is it? Turn with me to Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10, verse 28. And we see that we have an eternal reward. Then Peter began to say to him, "See, we have left all and followed you." So Jesus answered and said, "Assuredly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brother or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake and the gospel's, who shall not receive a hundredfold now in this life, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands without persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life." Let me tell you, I had somebody came to me just recently and said, "I don't understand why my whole family is in chaos. Nobody likes anybody. And I feel so alone because I don't have a family. I want a family. But I don't feel like I have a family because everybody fights all the time. And I don't know what to do." And my response was, and I believe that response was led by the Holy Spirit. And what I shared was that, you know, we have no say in our family, in our natural family. God chooses that family for us. Now, they choose how they're going to respond, how they're going to act toward us. They choose how they're going to act toward each other. Okay? But what happens is when you get into the family of God, you have, you can have a family of God that that God has brought together through church and through fellowship that is much closer, much more loving, much more forgiving, and much more committed, just a group of Christians, than you can ever have in a natural family. A dear friend yesterday, matter of fact, the guy that I work for, I picked him up at the airport, and he was sharing with me, because he just came back from Iran, he was sharing me about what happened with his family. And when his dad died, he had left the inheritance. It was three boys. And he left the youngest son 65% of the inheritance. He left the oldest son 10% of the inheritance. No, wait a minute. No, 25%, I'm sorry. 25% of the inheritance. And then he left Joe, my boss, 10%. He was the middle child. And then the older brother got mad because the younger brother got most of the money. Well, the younger brother was a drug addict and an alcoholic.
Whoa.
So in less than a year, he was broke. The older brother talked the middle brother, my boss, my friend, into going together and making a business investment. And then he turned around and 1 year later and sold it without telling my friend about it. And then when Joe found out about it, and he contacted his older brother, said, "What happened? You sold this. What happened to the money?" And he said, "I spent it all."
Oh my gosh.
And he said, "Well, we need to meet. We need to talk." And he said, "We have nothing to talk about."
Oh my gosh. It's worse.
So he was saying, "I'm the black sheep of the family. Why do family members treat us like this, George?" I said, "Because they're all blind, Joe. They're all blind. They're all self-centered. It's all about me." I told him, I said, "Well, you know, my wife has a perfect identification of the modern generation, society today. It's the I am generation. It's all about me. I am God of my world. So it's all about me." And that's the way the world looks at things now. It's all about me. And anything I want to do in my world is okay. Okay, see, but what happens is we get, like we just finished reading, okay, over in Peter, where he says, "But God's been showing you all along, showing you, revealing himself, and because they chose not to see him, they got the results of their lifestyle." So, we have to learn to set our priorities, establish our priorities by God's standards, not by the world's standards, which is all about me, all right? Because if we do it by God's standards, we have an eternal reward. Not only in this life, he says, "Who shall not receive 100 for my sake?" Okay, let me back up just a little bit. "No one who has ever left house, brothers, sisters, father, mother, or wife, or children, or lands, even land, or property, for my sake and the gospel's sake, who shall not receive 100-fold now in this life," hello, houses. We're going to get houses, guys. If we do it by God's standards, we're going to get stuff. God doesn't want you to be poor because you can't help support missionaries when you're poor. He wants you to have money so you can support the kingdom of God. He wants you to have stuff so you can give it away. Support the kingdom of God. Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, beginning verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but walk according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life is Christ Jesus, in Christ Jesus, has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but walk according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can it be. So then those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not his. And if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit of life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. It gives us freedom. When we set our priorities by God's standards, it gives us freedom. Let's pray. Father, in this busy world, sometimes it's really hard to know what our priorities should be and how to get them organized according to your desires. Lord, help me to remember to ask you before I make a decision, so that my priorities will always be in line with your priorities for my life. Father, remind me if I move, if I make a move, if I make a decision without asking you first. Remind me, Lord, before it's done. Lord, I don't ever want to be out of position. Lord, I don't ever want to set a priority in my life unless it's set by your standards. Father, help us. Help us, Lord, to listen, to ask, to seek, to knock. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.